Next, we will discuss future search, groupware, hotlines, and just like general internet tools. So future search is a 2.5 day event designed to result in a common vision of the future. This is why it's called future search. And you will watch a video that explains the reasoning behind it and the different tasks that go in that happen during a future search conference.
Suppose you have an urgent problem involving several parties, each with their own interests. You know that no one can solve the problem on their own, but that they can each block any solutions others might offer. What do you do? You show that to find a solution they need each other and that they should therefore collaborate. You organize a future search. A what? A future search. A meeting where all the parties work together to create their shared future. But how do you do that? First, find an inspiring location. Then make sure everyone who has a stake in the outcome attends. And that together they develop a shared, action-oriented vision for the future. Is it really that easy? Actually, yes it is. Though, obviously, there's a little more to it than that. First, you have to explore the problem with some of those involved and define the task. Then make it clear to everyone that they must participate in the Future Search Conference. You do that through smart communication, a website, newspaper, personal invitations, funny campaigns, etc. Then bring all the stakeholders together in one room. Lay down the boundaries within which the solution must be achieved. Make the participants aware of their past and their present, and allow them to create their shared future. In this way, they discover how and where their interests overlap. Based on this mutual understanding, those involved can themselves formulate exactly what they are going to do in the short term to make this new future possible, giving all the participants ownership of the solution. So, is that it? No, that's just the beginning. A lot of energy has been released. Use it. Support the new initiatives. Follow them and ensure that all the participants keep each other updated on achieved results. Want to know more? www.capzet.nl, where form, content and process come together.
The author is defining here groupware, which is a very generic term to use number of like electronic technologies that support collaboration between groups. And this obviously could have like in person or virtually, including some meetings. So you should read that part because it's related to technologies. This book is like pretty old, so the examples that are provided there are not that great, but for new examples you might say, you know, Trello is a great tool where people can do like project management and do some collaboration together. But there's like many of them, many of those different kinds of tools. You can always go with the old-fashioned hotline, which is basically just advertise a number that is like advertised everywhere in all your postcards, flyers, surveys that you tell people when you see them, and it will be like an 800 number. The city has like many of these numbers that they create for different plans and projects. So basically it's just like a regular phone number where, you know, someone in the office, in that department will answer the phone and just give like information. But it's like perceived as something that is like highly accessible because maybe sometimes it's not only assigned to one person in the office, but it's like anyone could like get the hotline, so you could get transfer, and you make sure that somebody actually answers the phone when someone calls. Some internet tools might be just like using chat rooms, web conferencing, or any other virtual communication as primary mechanisms for participation. With Zoom, Google Hangouts, Skype, you're very familiar with what that would look like. Other techniques might include the open house, in where you basically invite people to come to City Hall, show them some posters and some things that you have been working on or a developer has been working on. Of course, you can do open house in libraries and in other places in the community. The closer that they are to the development that is being proposed, probably the better. Other techniques include the role appraisal, open space, and participatory technology assessments. So we already discussed a little bit of the open house, but you will have like a variety of booths and stations around a specific topic, and the more fun that you make it, the better. But basically you have an open house for 4 hours and you talk to people that come to the open house, and hopefully the person receiving people, it will be pretty knowledgeable so they can answer the questions of people. You already have tried open space. It has like some resemblance to the charrette in the fact that you can have open space in only 1 hour, but usually you will do it two times, three times. You can have like a regular conference and then kind of have open spaces for having people to discuss what they want to discuss. So the whole idea of the open space is that the people say, this is the topic that I want to discuss, and they put it on the wall, and then people are like, yeah, I'm gonna go there and put like leave the post-its with their name, and then people can move around to different topics that are happening and they don't have to stay in a single space. So again, this is very dynamic, but it's like really great when you do it several times in a conference. So that's why it's similar to the charrette. You just simply say, you know, this is the theme that we are going to discuss. And within the theme, anything goes. So people can choose whatever specific topic they want to discuss. A group technique to enable local rural people to participate, not as a sources of information, but also analyzing the information leading to a particular development project, for example, in a farming village. PRA has many tools, such as that could be used like community mapping, in where basically you will map all the assets that are in a community. Maybe it's the farm, but maybe there's also like the market, farmer's market. You will mark where the different farms are, or you could say, okay, this is like the roads, those are also assets. So basically you make a community map with the people in the village. And you can see what are the different resources that are available. In many of these exercises, you also talked about wealth ranking, because in many communities that are villages, there might be a person that has like more resources than other people. So the idea is like, what can they contribute for the whole community? Well, there might be other people that have like more of the labor to contribute, so they will contribute more of that. Well, the one will might contribute land or water or other kinds of resources. That's why you would do also like a wealth ranking in the community. There's also things like transit walk, which is like the community goes together and walks in a farm or in a trail, and then you see what are the different resources and has a conversation about that particular space. You can also, besides the wealth ranking, you also can map what are the roles that people have. Like women might have different roles, or young women have different roles than older women in a village, and the same thing for young males, or youth, and then or older males. So what are the roles of people in the community, and what are they doing, and how can they contribute? Also, what are the skills that they bring? So maybe women are better at selling things in the market, carrying water, and things like that, versus like men will go and work in the farm. Women will cook, those kinds of things. There's also Venn diagrams that could be used in order to find where different resources might overlap. Matrix scoring are other tools, and you can explore this more on your own. But there's a lot of very interesting techniques that are used when you are in a very rural context, particularly in other countries in Asia or Latin America or Africa.